Now, if you all don't mind, would you just rise again? Let's all rise together. I still see some people sitting. Yes, I can see things from here. Don't think I can't. And can we all please welcome Mishi to the front?
Awesome. Thank you, Sam. Would you stay standing, family? Stay standing. Stay standing, because I want you to get the greater portion of blessing. So I'm going to ask you to pray for me. Can you do that? So on the count of three, we're going to family style it. Ask the Lord just to release a download of his heart and that we would be able to receive all of it. So one, two, ready, go. Yes, Papa, we believe that when your presence comes, miracles can happen, God. And so we just invite more of your presence to come and fill this room till overflowing on this, the last day, the greatest day of the day and the Feast of Tabernacles. God, we're believing that you're going to release a mighty river in this place. And that, Lord, not only on the outside, God, but on the inside, the rivers of living water, Lord, would it spring up from the ground, God, whether the fountains of our hearts be overflowing this morning with the good news of who you are and who we are because of you. Lord, we just thank you this morning that you want to release fresh revelation of your heart as a father. And so as your sons and daughters, we say yes and amen. Whatever you want to do, however you want to move, we say yes and amen to the perfect leadership that you have as our good, good father. We thank you. We pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Awesome. On your way down, go ahead and hug somebody. Say, I'm glad that we are family. Yes. Get cozy. You're going to be, literally, some of you are family sitting next to each other. That's adorable. Yes. Get comfy and cozy with the person next to you. So this is awesome. I am so thankful to the Lord that I'm able to stand here right now. This is a miracle. You can ask the people who were at my house for worship night last night. By the end of the night, I was like, I was struggling. I got hit with some sort of like 24-hour flu bug or something. And I was like dazed and confused. I think I was concerning the kiddos who were at my house. Who was at my house for worship night? Woo! They were all like, shababa, Mishi. She looks like she's on her deathbed, but I'm standing, hallelujah. It's both the anointing of the Lord of the Holy Spirit and also praise Jesus for medicine. So I feel both the anointing, and I'm not sure if it's the medicine and the drugs, but I feel really good right now. It's awesome. And so as I was asking Papa about this message this morning, and it's Elevate Sunday, he gave me this idea for a really, really quick game that we're going to play. It's Elevate Sunday, so we get to do what we want. Hallelujah. And so I originally was going to get you all to do this, but I think it'll be too much chaos and confusion. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to divide you into sections, okay? Sections, is that all right? So like these first three rows is going to be one team. My man say yes. Yeah. Okay, these guys right here, your three rows are one team. Yes, yes, okay. All right, you three rows is another team, and then the on the side, you guys can join these three in the back. Can I get a woo? Wee, awesome. And then you to the front, these four to the front. You guys are the last team. Woo, awesome. All right, with your teams, I want you guys to decide two people to be your representative, so send two people to the front, every team. Send me two. Send me two. And that person's going to need to be able to walk around and move or maybe run really fast. So you got to pick two people that are able to go. So two, send me two. Quickly, come on, 30 seconds. Send up two people, yes, come up front. Send up your two representatives. So representing team one, where are they at? Team two? Are you guys team two? Woo! Team one, where's team one? Come on. Yeah. You're the back, team three. You're in team three, you're over here. And team four, wait, no. Oh. You're team four. Okay, team three, team four. Awesome. I need team one. What happened to my team one? You two? Okay, cool. Albert and Kelly. All right, here we go. All right, round one. Here's the deal. We're playing Gimme Gimme, but kind of on a speed round, Gimme Gimme. So I want you to go back to your group. You could decide amongst yourselves how to do this, but I want you to find me the first Gimme Gimme. Give me something that you think is the most valuable thing under $100. Ready? One, two, three, go. Give me something that's the most valuable thing under $100. All right, once you have it, stay in the front. Most valuable thing under $100. Under $100. You can't give a person. He's not under $100. Okay, wait. Just wait. We'll explain. $100, you guys gotta bring something. You can't bring something. All right. So we're gonna do a vote to seeing which one we think is the most valuable, okay? We're going to start with group one. Group one here. Okay, let's explain. Group one, what do you have and why do you think it's the most valuable thing under $100, okay?
We have essential biology with physiology, and it's the most valuable because knowledge is priceless.
Oh, all right. Very good. Okay, second team. Most valuable thing under $100, what is it?
This hydro flask. Because I think this is like $70-ish. Was that what it was? Okay, and then.
So it costs around like $70-ish. It's pretty expensive.
Whenever it dents, like my heart. Another reason.
Not only that, but this also contains water, and water is essential for biology. And if you think about it, without water, you're gonna be dead. So that's valuable. There's life in this bottle.
All right. Good. Team three. Okay, team three. Please explain, what is your most valuable thing under $100? Explain.
So this is the most valuable out of all of them because this is $80. And plus, if you really hate someone who carries this bag, then you could like take it and then ransom it for even more. So this is obviously the most valuable.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. Enoch, very good. All right, last but not least, my ladies, what is the most valuable thing?
Well, because there's a water bottle inside it, so it can carry as much stuff as you want to be inside, so yeah.
Carrier things. Okay, show of votes. All right. Raise of hands. Ready? Do you think number one is the winner? Show your hands. Raise your hands. Who thinks number one's the winner? All right. Juping, help me to discern which one wins, okay? That's number one. Okay, very good. Number two. Who thinks number two is the winner? Okay, take a look. All right. Okay, number three. Who thinks number three is the winner? Show hands. Okay, not so much. Okay, team four. Who thinks team four is the winner? I mean, a lot of them voted for their own thing, but what do you think?
I don't know. I think it's like gender specific and generation specific. Well, can we do one quick one? It's kind of hard to tell.
Let's try it again. Number one, show of hands. Okay, number two. They're voting for themselves. Okay, here's the rule. You cannot vote for your own, okay? We're changing it up. You cannot vote for your own team, okay? Now let's vote, okay? Cannot vote for your own team. Okay, let's start with four. So four, who thinks four is the most valuable? Okay, who thinks three is the most valuable thing? You can't vote for your own team. Can't vote for your own team. Okay, that's pretty valuable. We got three or four hands. Okay, who thinks number one, number two, pretty valuable? Can't vote for your own team. Oh, there's a lot. Okay, there's more. All right, all right. Who thinks number one is the most valuable? Who? What do you think? Number two. All right, winners. Number one is for group two. Awesome. Okay, go back, go back. Give your item back. All right, hold on. Come up front, come up front. One more round. Second round. Stand up. I want you to find me the most valuable thing in the room. One more time. We're going to do three rounds, so this is round two. Most valuable thing in the room under $500. Ready? One, two, three, go. Under $500. No, you cannot carry a person. Item, 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 under $500. Make sure you get permission to touch it. Under $500. Team one is back. Team one is back. Under $500, most valuable thing. All right, all right, all right, all right. Okay, good job. Are you done? Where's your partner? Caleb. Okay, we're gonna start in reverse order. We'll start with group four. Group four, tell us what is your most valuable thing.
It's a Bible. It's a Bible because it's God's word, so yeah.
It's a Bible, it is God's word, so yeah. That's pretty good. Awesome, team four. Okay, team three, what is the most valuable thing you guys got?
Apple is the most expensive.
Apple's the most expensive phone, this is true. So they have a phone. It also has a Bible in it.
Yes, a Bible. It's called online.
You get the power of online. Very good. Awesome. Team two, what do we got?
We have Matt's credit card.
Matt's credit card.
And I'm told there's only $500 in here.
Okay, thanks, Matt. I'll keep this for later. Awesome. And is that it? Okay, so Matt's credit card for $500. Thank you, Matt. Awesome. Team one, what do you guys have?
Tablet.
Tablet. Explain to us why this is the most valuable thing under $500.
Because it holds personal information like tax files and bank account info. And
so it holds the Bible, your account information, and also it has all the functions of a phone minus the phone.
Okay. All right, remember the rule, you cannot vote for your own team, so vote for another team. Are you ready? So, what? Oh, sorry. Oops. Here you go, here's the credit card. Okay, all right. Who thinks team one, most valuable thing in the room under $500? Awesome. We got like four hands, four or five hands. Okay, very good. All right. Team two, credit card. Who thinks this is pretty impressive? All right, let's look at the hands. Count the hands, the $500 credit card limit. Awesome. All right. Can't vote for your own team, remember. Can't vote for your own team. All right, team three, who thinks the phone? iPhone. iPhoneology. Awesome. Very good. All right, who thinks team four, the Bible? Show of hands, some of you did not vote. Tie between four and two, let's try it again. All right, who thinks number two is the most valuable? Show of hands, you can't vote for yourself. Matt, who thinks it's the most valuable? Credit card, $500 credit card limit, awesome. Okay, Bible, show of hands, one more time. Everybody needs to vote, let's go. Okay, Bible's the winner. Last thing, okay. Last round. You ready, guys? Come back one more time. Last round. Okay, here it is. Last round, okay? You can't, FYI, you cannot use any of the items you've previously used. So you can't bring up the Bible again, you can't bring up anything else. So it has to be a brand new item, and no other group has brought it up either, okay? Groups, remember? It's a new item that no one else has brought up. The most valuable thing, there is no limit. Ready, set, go. Most valuable item, no limit. No cap. No limit. Okay. All right. Oh, you get only one item. One item. Seconds. 30. 15 seconds, 15, 14, 13, 12, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. We're gonna start in the middle this time, okay? And then we'll go around. Okay, starting with group three, what have you brought with us that's the most valuable item with no price tag?
This is Tabby. She's the most valuable because she's made in God's image, and no other person just like Tabby.
Made in the image of God, that's pretty good. All right, what did you guys bring?
We got the judge. She's important. She's made in God's image also, and
she's fully function, and she has fully functioning organs.
Okay. What the heck?
All right, fully functional organs, and she's a judge. All right, very good. All right, coming back here, group one. What did you bring, and why?
What? Albert chose me playing an instrument.
And why is it the most valuable? You gotta explain.
Because no one else can play an instrument and sing like she can. Kelly probably does it better.
He said Kelly probably does it better. Okay. All right, worship person. All right, here we go. What is your team? What did you bring?
So we brought our buddy Jeffrey here, and we believe one of the most important skills is to be able to speak for yourself. Is that right, Jeffrey?
No.
Exactly. There we go. So there's our reasoning right there.
Yes. Awesome. Okay, let's put it to a vote. Now, who thinks team three is the winner? Show of hands. Show of hands. Team three. Very good. Keep your hands raised so that we can count it. Okay, good. Both parents have raised the hands. Okay, good. All right, who thinks number four is the winner? The judge.
I can see you.
She's counting those hands. Elder of the house. Okay, we saw the hands. Did you count the hands? Okay. All right, over here, who thinks team two is the winner? Show of hands. You can't vote for yourself back there. Y'all can't vote for yourself. Okay, the one in the back is fine. Okay, you see the hands? Okay, all right. Who thinks team one's the winner? Yay. Who's the winner? Our Tabby. Most valuable thing, no price tag. All right, go ahead, go get your seats. Awesome, awesome, awesome. With your reps coming back, give them a hug, say good job. Good job, awesome job, reps. Not only bringing up the items, but they are good salesmen. We found some good salesmen in the house. Very good. So today, the word that the Lord gave me was inheritance. Can you say inheritance? and us understanding not only what is inheritance, but the value of inheritance. That was the thing that the Lord was pressing on my heart. And even just coming back from homecoming, which I'm thankful that we get to share the fruit of that experience and being a witness to what happened at homecoming in Kansas City, the thing that the Lord kept putting on my heart is inheritance. And so, being that's Elevate Sunday, youth, I love you. You know the rule. If I see your cell phone, I see you're on your cell phone, it is mine. Thank you. We're no longer playing the game, so you don't need your phones, okay? Inheritance. And so, can you put up the slide, my love? I think it's really important in order for us to value our inheritance, we need to know how much it's worth, right? And so I have this clip. I think on the inside of me is like a grandma because I like baking and like the Great British Bake Show. Any Great British Bake Show fans? Woo! Yes, it's such a good show. They're so great. It's a competition, but they're so encouraging. I love that show. And like, I love knitting. Any knitters in the house? Hoot hoot. Knitters and crafters. Oh, I gotta talk to you, Ami, later. There's this new show called Making It. I don't know, have you seen it? They do wood things, and I'm impressed. Anyone know Parks and Rec, the guy named Ron Swanson? That dude? He's like Mr. Grumpkins. He's a very grumpy dude. He actually can build wood things. Like, he's not just an actor. He builds, like, boats and canoes. It's a really cool show. Anyways, it's like Great British Bake Show, American version, but with crafting. And they're encouraging, and they cry when people leave. It's so powerful. Anyways, another show that's probably too old for y'all, and you probably don't watch, is called The Antique Roadshow. Anybody know what The Antique Roadshow is? Okay, I want to show you this clip, and then we'll talk about it in a minute, so... Athena, help me out.
This particular piece has been in our family for as long as I can remember. When I was a little girl, this lamp lived in my grandmother's home. We used to love playing with it. When it was lit, we would call it the brain lamp.
The brain lamp?
The brain lamp, yes, yes.
I understand why.
Yes. We also used to do a lot of dressing up as kids, and we would, like, turn it so that we could also use it as a spotlight for our performances. So it's a very heartfelt piece for our family. So.
Well, there was a glass called brain glass.
Really?
Yes, but this isn't it.
Oh, okay.
This is actually a turtleback tile iridescent glass.
Okay.
And the glass is thinner than you would see in other items of bigger form.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit thin. It's usually not signed. I will never say
can
never.
Can you pause it for a second?
Not signed.
Pause the video. Wait. Before she says the value, I want you to think to yourself, don't say it out loud, how much do you think that lamp is worth? Shh. Don't say it out loud. I said think to yourself. All right, now play. Go ahead and play.
And this is a bronze base, patinated bronze all the way down to the feet mm-hmm. with a lily pad. The good news is it is Tiffany.
Oh, my God. Oh, Kathy, that's fantastic.
The good news.
Okay.
And the bronze bottom does have on the foot the Tiffany Studios mark, and this lamp is circa 1910. Now, this chain has been put on here later. This is a process that can be reversed to make it the way it was originally, which should get done to the piece.
Oh, right.
That does hurt the value a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
With regard to replacing the chain, it wouldn't be very expensive. My guess is it would be a few hundred dollars.
And it would be specifically a Tiffany chain,
you would
correct?
Have to take it to a Tiffany specialist to get
the
specific Tiffany piece. As far as increasing the value on this piece, it would probably increase it maybe by $500 or $600. It wouldn't be a huge amount.
Great.
Now, I found a couple auction records. This was very difficult to find. It's extremely rare. And I would say today, in a retail market, you might find this piece at 30,000 to $40,000.
Oh my gosh. Wow. Wow. Oh my gosh. Kathy, thank you so much. I can't believe it. Wow.
30 to 40,000. Anyone think 30 to 40,000 are in that ballpark? Price is Right? Winners? Pretty cool. Awesome. Can we get the lights back on? So, as a little girl, that woman on the show was saying how they would play around with that lamp. They used it as like a spotlight. Like, oh, we're gonna dress up and we're just gonna play around. You look at that thing, I mean, it looks like a brain, like a green brain. I mean, how many of you guys would have seen it in the attic and been like, not my style, it's going in the junk heap, right? Honestly, probably wouldn't keep that thing, right? But if you knew what its value was, you knew who the maker and how rare it was to find, man, you would be cherishing that thing to the point where even like the little chain on that thing is $500, the chain on the lamp. Knowing the value of an inheritance changes our heart attitude and our posture towards it. I want to go through this story with you guys. Who remembers the story of Esau and Jacob? Anybody? Remember the story of Esau and Jacob? Can you scroll down to my fourth slide, my love? Let's read it together. Can we do this? So this is out of Genesis chapter 25, and we're starting up in verse 27. Let's read it together. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man in the field, while Jacob was a quiet man dwelling in the tents. Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was cooking stew, Esau saw it from the field, and he was exhausted. And Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stew, for I am exhausted." Therefore his name was called Edom. Jacob said, "Sell me your birthright now." Esau said, "I'm about to die, or what use is it a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me now." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. Now, in the context of this verse, you have to understand birthright was incredibly important to the tribal nations, to the nomadic people. Your birthright was more than just, oh, I get to be the first son, right? As the right of the first son, you are the rightful heir to everything that your father has. But more than that, you actually get double portion. Everything that your fathers have, you get double portion, and the generations after you will get to have that portion. So Esau and Jacob were twins, right? Even in the womb, they were like competitive, fighting each other. But Esau, being the stronger one, came out first. What did you read at the very last verse? What did it say, that last sentence? Can you read it again? Say it nice and loud. I didn't see my young people read it. One more time. What did it say? He despised his birthright or his inheritance. He sold his inheritance for basically a bowl of porridge, a bowl of congee. That's what he decided. That's how much his inheritance is worth. Why do you think he did this? As I was studying scripture, what hit me was two things. And you can read it in the very first verse. Esau, as he grew up, he was two things. What did they describe him as being? First, he's the what? Skillful hunter, and the second description of Esau is man of the field. So you might just read and happen these two verses or these two descriptions and think it's not a big deal, but I think they're the very thing that undermined Esau from valuing what his father had to give him. Because the first part, it says he was a skillful hunter. This tells me that Esau, he felt like he could survive on his own. Right? He could go out to the field. He had skills to do whatever he wanted. He might have been like, you know, Katniss Everdeen times a million. I don't know. Just being able to shoot and hunt and be able to survive by his skills. And this is a trap that many of the second generation fall into. Because like Esau, a lot of us, why there's this generational curse or break, and why in Malachi it says there's this promise to turn the hearts of the older generation to the younger and the younger to the older, it's because there's actually a curse. Young people, tell me, there's a curse. Say it again. Young people, tell me, there's a curse. That has broken the bond of where two generations come together. In Psalms, it says one generation could take on how many? Who knows their verses? Who knows the Bible? A person can take on 1,000, but two people can take on 10,000. One person, 1,000. Two people, 10,000. One of the key kingdom principles is two generations walking together. The enemy hates it, so he divides. So one of the things, young people, that we get stuck, the younger generation, is that we think that we're skillful, that we don't need the older generation to survive. We know how to use a computer better than our moms and dads. Moms and dads, printer function. Press this to print. How many of you guys, younger people, have had to teach your parents how to use technology? Anybody? Show of hands. Older people, how many of you guys have asked the younger people to teach you about technology? Show of hands. Very good. We're skillful. We've grown up in an age where there's more resources for us. And though it's supposed to strengthen us, what it's done is that it's caused us to become prideful. What Matthew 5 tells me, it's not the prideful who inherit the earth. Who is it? The meek. Matthew 5:5. It is the meek that will inherit the earth. As a younger generation, the enemy fools us into false pride of we can survive without the older generation. We don't need what they have to give us. We could do it on our own because we could do it faster, better, and more efficient. But that's not the way that God's kingdom works. He's not about fastness or efficiency. Look at anything in creation. I see that God is not about efficiency. He's about process. Can you say process? He cares more about us learning to love than he does about us getting the job done. So that was the first mistake that Esau fell into, the first trap. What was the second trap? What was the second description? What was the second description? A man of the field. Now you might be like, what kind of trap is that? Man likes to work. Isn't that awesome? Man was made to work. Yes, man was made to work. But here's the difference. While I believe Esau was out in the field, managing the land, working the field, he prioritized work or his vision of doing labor than he did relationship. Jacob was in the tent. Jacob was with his dad. And even in his dad's weakened state, he's blind, he's on his deathbed, he saw that his dad had a blessing he wanted. And though he went about it the wrong way, I'm not excusing how Jacob got his birthright, he went after it with such a jealousy because he knew the value of it. He wasn't going to let his bigger, stronger, faster brother get what he really wanted, and that was his father's blessing. Sometimes we as a family, we can prioritize ministry, work, doing a good job, which is not bad things. But sometimes the enemy of the blessing and the best of your life is actually the good. Because we prioritize the things that we think are important over what God thinks is important. So my question to you families, have you sold your inheritance for a bowl of porridge? I went to homecoming and I got to share a little bit last week. Oh, before I go there, let's read this other verse. Hebrews 12:15-16. We'll read it together real quick. See to that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled, that no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. Isn't that interesting that God equates even sexual immorality to the bitterness and ignorance that Esau had? Later on in that verse, it talks about how Esau wasn't given an opportunity to repent. He wasn't. Once he lost his birthright, he lost it. But I'm thankful we're not living during that time. That instead we're living in a time where Jesus came, firstborn from the dead, that we can now receive the inheritance through his blood, in despite of our own weaknesses and brokenness. I shared last week about my journey to going to homecoming, and as I shared last week, if you weren't here, the Lord tricked me. Tricked me real good. I'm very thankful. I didn't realize I had been counting. It's like sometimes you get busy in work and in ministry. You kind of like lose sight of what's happening outside of your bubble. And so even for me, I didn't even realize how significant this year is for me. It's the beginning of my 10th year at Forerunner, guys. I've been here for a decade. That's scary. Ten years ago, the Lord said, come and follow me, sell everything that you have. Little did I know what the Lord was bringing me into. I think if the Lord told me everything, I'd probably have been like, no, I'm going to stay here. Jersey's great. I'll deal with the snow. But, you know, like, little did I know the journey that it would be and how great his reward is in choosing obedience. And in the last year, 2 years especially, the Lord's really taught me how to trust and love more than just like respect, but there's this shift that happened on the inside of my heart where I don't just respect my leaders, I'd be willing to lay my life down for them. It's a very big difference. Because when you respect someone, you're like, oh yeah, like, your ministry is great. And as long as I'm a part of your ministry, like, I'm for you. But, like, once that tie kind of severs, like, we're done with each other, right? It's like we'll be the people that walk into Costco and you're like, oh, you kind of remember that person. You're like, oh, hi. And then you walk away. You know what I'm talking about? Y'all have done it. Where you're like people you've broken relationship with because the tie that bonded you was not family. It was duty or obligation. It was circumstantial. And so I found the Lord take me out of a place where I was just bonded to people by ministry to now bonds of love, where no matter where I would go, to the ends of the earth, these people will be my family forever. Suddenly my affection and my love for them has dramatically changed. It's weird, sometimes I think about Elder Nikki and I just start to cry. Because to you, she's your elder. But to me, she's my mama, who I know will fight for me to the last days of my life. Now, if you know the two of us, even though we're like similar size height-wise, look at this. We are dramatically different in the way that we function and the way that we are. But I've seen her strength cover my weakness in such a loving, tender way. I've seen her fight for me. And no one will ever know how much she's labored in my life. I could spend the next 5 hours talking about this woman because she loves me. She loves me. She weeps over me. The other day when we were in IHOP, she whispered in my ear. I didn't ask permission to share this. I hope it's okay. But she told me how, like, she'll think about me in her house and she'll just start to cry or she'll laugh. And that lets her know that I'm in her heart. Not just her coworker, I'm not just her leader, I'm her daughter. Something crazy's happened, family, where we're not relating to each other because of our ministry function. She's not just my leader, my supervisor, my person over me. She is the one who covers me with love, who fights for my calling and my destiny, and whom I'm willing to lay my life down for. And so, fast forward a little bit, here comes homecoming, and I shared with you guys, like, I'm learning to be a good daughter, and so Mama Nikki was like, whole English department, we're going to IHOP. Like, we're taking time off, and we're going to go. And, you know, as a good daughter, I was just like, okay, sure, yeah, that sounds good. I'm just trying to be good. Like, I'm trying to, like, obey her and, like, understand her and not, like, fight with her about it. Because, like, in the back of my mind, my thoughts about ministry starts clicking, like, oh, my gosh, it's September. It's mid-September. We have a bunch of new leaders. We have so many events happening. I can't take even 4 days off. This is not a good idea. I have not taken days off in a very long time. Before then, I only took like 3 days off. I have like something like 150 hours of PTO stored up, y'all. I could disappear for a month, but I won't. anyways, just to let you know, because I don't take time off because I love our family, love what God's doing, and I take heavy the responsibility that he's put on me. So I want to be here all the time. So even taking 4 days off to go to a place that I love so much, like IHOP, it was a big cost thing she was asking of me. But I found myself, I was surprised. I was just like, yes, booking it now. And I booked it really fast. But I thought, you know, maybe I'll take these 4 days and I'll just come to some of the meetings. But other times, I'm just going to take some time for myself and I'll sneak out because there's this shuttle that runs from the FCF, which is where the main meeting is, and where the prayer room is. And so I was like, when Elder Nikki is not looking and she's, you know, translating, I'll be like, hee, hee, hee. And then just jump on the bus and then go to the prayer room for a couple hours. It's not a bad thing. That was what I thought I was coming to do. But I'm so thankful that Papa God had other plans. And instead, I got to see the birthing of something that I know our generation is going to be reaping from for years to come. My own prophetic history, I fell in love with Jesus in the prayer room. It was in a tiny, itty-bitty prayer room in the middle of Lancaster, Pennsylvania in 2001. How many of you guys were not born yet? 2001. Look at all these youngins. My baby's in the room. Look at Tabby. She's like, me. Yeah, 2001. I'm not going to tell you how old I was because you're going to like be able to figure out my age. But I went to this prayer room because I never had heard of IHOP, One Thing, or anything. I just got divinely connected to this group that came from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And they just invited us to stay in their house, and there was going to be this gathering. And I just remember sitting in that prayer room and just weeping. It's like, have you guys ever walked into like a steam shower before? You guys ever walk, like you turn on the shower in your bathroom and you close the door, you walk in and all of a sudden there's this like, whoosh. There's this like heaviness of like mist and the weight in the air. Have you guys ever seen Scooby-Doo? Is that too old for y'all? Scooby-Doo can like, he would like, there's this clip where he always like cuts out of the fog like a circle. And he, like, eats the donut because he's always hungry. Scooby-Doo. Because the fog is that thick. It's that heavy. It was like that for me, walking into the prayer room. But there was no fog and there was no mist. There was just a glory. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, in 2 Chronicles, when they were blessing and honoring the temple, Solomon, who was honoring his father's dream and building this temple, lay no expense, gave it all that he had, all that he was, to see the fulfillment of his father's dream. When they blessed it, the glory cloud was so thick, the priest couldn't sing, like do his job. The musicians couldn't sing. Everyone was just flat and laid out in the presence. And if you guys know what I'm talking about, can you nod my head? Nod your head. Yes. That kind of atmosphere. I walked into the prayer room and I was like, I am not leaving. You know, it was already like 10 o'clock at night. And my fellow people who came with me were like, we got to go back to our hotel. I'm like, it's going okay. Leave me here. Leave me here. Because for them, it was different. Something was happening for me. God was marking my heart that this is where I was made for, to be in his presence. For them, they wanted the immediate pleasure of their pillow. But I tasted something in that room that was infinitely more pleasurable than my pillow in my bed. I just had to have it. So fast forward here. We come to homecoming. And how many of you guys have been to homecoming gatherings before? Show of hands. Who came to the homecoming gathering here? All right, be honest. How many of your first reactions are like, this is weird? Yes? Y'all know? Like, these Chinese people dancing, they're doing like, I don't know, it's like, it looks like the Irish version of the jig sometimes. They're like kicking, and the flags and the banners, and everyone's moving, and they're doing like jazzercise. Like, let's get exercise in the presence, you know? Honestly, the first homecoming I went to, I was like, what is this craziness? Like, did I come into a Chinese dance club? Or is this supposed to be a service? And I had a run of just like a lot of just judgmental thoughts of what I saw was happening on the stage. And it's easy to look at that and dismiss the move of God of what he's doing. Because like Esau, we're seeing things out of our either immediate pleasure, like what benefits me right now. And man, I could do it better. If I was running that show, we would not have the jazzer kicks. We would do like something more spiritual, right? I'm not alone in this. I know y'all had those thoughts go through your mind. I could do it better. But in that prideful arrogance, right, pride comes before fall, we miss the goodness of what God has. So now coming to IHOP for me, seeing these Byron white people, the Byrons, Byron, who are like the most holy people in my mind, right? That are like, oh, night and day prayer, Jesus. Like these holy, holy people, like Alan Hood and David Slager, these really, really white bread people. I'm sorry, I'm not being racist, but they're from the middle of Kansas City, right? And oh my gosh, y'all, they were dancing with the Chinese. They were losing their marbles, just going for God's presence with people that's not their culture, and it's not their way of dancing, but they were so hungry. They saw, if this is a move of God, I'm gonna do whatever it takes to get in it. They didn't worry about saving face. They didn't sit in the back like a bystander and just judge them. Like, I don't understand what's happening, or this is not my language, or this is not my people. As ABCs, we have missed out so much because of that deception of division the enemy has done. That's my parents' language. I don't want that. It's not my parents' worship. I don't like it. I could do it better. And all the while, while we're stuck in those old thoughts, we're missing the goodness of the Lord that could be found. I'm going to show you a short clip. And to explain a little bit, this is Mama Bickle. This is Diane Bickle. She is Mike Bickle's wife. How many of you guys have never seen Diane Bickle before? Show of hands. You've seen IHOP before, but you've never seen Diane Bickle before. Now, here's really an important thing. So Mike has been this incredible teacher, prophet to the nations. Like, he stands in the place of leadership. He has a very strong vision. Night and day prayer, this burden that the Lord has given him. And he's been faithful. He's carried it out when other people, after like a year or even like a month, would have been like, too much, 24/7 prayer going on all the time. They would have given up. This is their 19th year anniversary that homecoming happened on the day, their 19th anniversary. Mike and his team have been faithful and like not giving up as a company, that God is worthy of 24/7 prayer. All night and day, he's worthy of worship. And he's led his team to do that. But you would notice that his family is never on the stage with him. And I've heard it from like others in the IHOP leadership, why that is. It's not because their family doesn't love each other. They actually love each other very deeply. Diane and Mike's marriage is one of the most beautiful things. They love each other very deeply. They honor one another very deeply. And they have two sons whom they love very much. But Diane has said it herself, and you hear her say it before. She never wanted to be on the stage. She would serve, like if you go to one thing, you'll see her be like the head usher. She'll be leading people to serve off stage, but she never ever wanted what was on stage because she hated living in a glass house. Do you know what that means? She understood that this was Mike's mandate that God had given her. She understood that that was the prophetic call, but she saw it as that's Mike's calling, it's not mine. So I'll support him, but not in a place where I have to stand next to him. Like, I'll be in the back. And she has a very thriving, like, very amazing business. She's an incredible businesswoman. There's nothing second to that. Like, I'm not diminishing that calling that she has. But there was this despising, and she said it herself. She didn't want to stand there with Mike. But during this homecoming, Diane was critical because she got the vision and she became desperate. So I want you to hear herself, hear from her, what she received from the Chinese people. Can you play it for us?
We're just gonna stand up here.
Oh, 44 minutes. There you go. Yeah.
And I was excited that they were coming. I had a trembling in my spirit.
Go back
I had
a
it
bit.
In
Sorry,
there.
Darling. A little bit more. 44. Can you see it? 44. Okay.
Like we owe a debt of gratitude to her letting the Holy Spirit touch her. In fact, we all at the end of this thing, we said, you're going to lead us for the next 3 months. To figure this out. We're gonna follow you. And we don't.
This is great. Oh, is it loading? Praise Jesus.
I was provoked to jealousy by just being with these people. And I was excited that they were coming. I had a trembling in my spirit, and I've had it in there for some little bit of time. And I knew that the Lord was going to surprise us in an amazing way, but I just didn't have any clue what that meant or looked like. I'll say the Lord gave us a huge gift when the Chinese people came and to hang out with us. To be with us, to hear our story, and to let us hear theirs. And in the hearing and the seeing and the receiving of their hearts and their tangible love that was poured out to us in a myriad of ways, it broke our hearts in love. It pressed us to the mat and overwhelmed us with the feeling of the Father's love and the love of our Chinese brothers and sisters, and then provoked us into desire that we would have that same caliber of love alive and operating in our church family and in our IHOP community, and knowing for all these years that the Lord has been preparing a place for his dwelling, knowing that he's coming back and that his end time scenario is crucial and key in this hour. And each one has felt preparations and given themselves to the individual preparation that they've known to do and felt to do, and we've done it corporately as a body. And I believe that just this gift has been like lifting off the veil so that we see more than we could ever see unless the Lord pulls back the veil and invites us into his loving family in a way that breaks through every bond, every shackle, every misplaced feeling in a human being's heart, because God is longing for his family, and we are longing for what God is longing for. We want God to have what he wants, and we don't even know what that's gonna look like. And we don't presume to roll out some game plan right now, because we don't really know what that looks like. But we know it's holy, and we know it's precious, it's costly. We know that it's gonna take all of us doing it together, because what God is wanting to birth in this nation and the nations of the earth is enormous. It is gigantic. It is bigger than what we can carry. And I just want to say one more thing. I have despised living in a glass house. And I'm calling that sin today. I'm repenting of that despising today. I want to live right where the Lord wants me to live. And I want to partner together with my family, the ones that the Lord has surrounded and put here in our midst. And I know that that is the heart of everybody in this leadership team, and the hearts of many, many, many of you. And so with a little bit more understanding and my yes and our yes, we're just wanting to step into whatever IHOP 2.0 is going to look like. But we know that it is passion for Jesus, and it is compassion for people.
Those were the two banners we had on the, for many years. It had a big, giant banner, passion for Jesus, compassion for people, for many years. That's what she's referring
because to. Because that's the heart of the Father. Because that's his heart, and he's put his heart in us. And we are going to carry his heart together with all of us. All of us, we're going to carry his heart. It's costly, it's precious, it's holy, and it's together.
Amen. You want to end it right there?
So we're asking the Lord to help us to raise up hundreds.
I was going to play a little bit longer originally. You could see that's Gabrielle, the one that's holding the mic now, that's almost due. She's pregnant. She's like, I think, less than a month before she's about to have her first child, and she came through the whole session. She went to all 8 sessions and even the in-between parts. What we don't see on camera is that in between every session of the homecoming, there was 8 sessions. Each session was like 4 hours maybe long. The leaders would come together and they would wait on the Lord for 3-4 hours together. Before every meeting, they would just ask God, what do you want to do, Lord? And during that time, that's when Diane got massively hit. And you could see the transformation. No longer is she afraid to take her place as a spiritual mom, but she's claiming her inheritance and what God's made her to be as a mother in that house. And Gabrielle, being the second generation, she was sharing in this video, and I want to encourage you to watch it yourself at home. If you can, you could go to the website. It's IHOP. Maybe we'll post it on like group chats everywhere. And so you guys can watch the sessions. I already posted on the Discord for the Vinaya people, but we'll send it to make sure everyone gets these links so you can kind of process it yourself. But you see Gabrielle standing there. She said, as a second generation, we receive you, we honor you. We cover your weaknesses. We know that you wanted to be spiritual moms and dads but couldn't do it to the best of your ability. We're not going to wait till you become the best mom and dads. We're choosing to stand alongside. David Slyker, at the end of this session, he gives a warning. He gives two things. He says this: when you see a move of God like this, there's two reactions that can stumble you from actually receiving. And the first is you think, what is there for me? Like, our first focus is like about me. Like, what do I get to benefit? How do I get out of it? And the second thing he said that people stumble is, well, I won't step in until I see other people change. Like, if my leaders change, if they actually change, then I'm not going to step in until I see that happen. So we stay as this bystander. So I want to challenge you, family. It's important, this critical hour. I literally cried my whole way home to you guys. One, because I was longing to come home. I missed you very much. But the other thing is that I didn't want you to miss what God is doing because of the deception of the enemy and because of our own pridefulness. I don't want you to miss this critical hour. It's not coincidence that today's the last day and the greatest day of the Day of Tabernacle. I didn't even know this till this morning until Mama texted me. She was like, did you know today's the last day? And I actually have the warning on my calendar because I have all the Jewish holidays on my calendar. And it like beep, beep. It's like Sukkot, beep, beep. And then I didn't. I was like too busy. I was like, I gotta get the videos right. Where's the video clip? And then I just like X'd out all my notifications. And then she messaged me this morning. Mama was just like, it's Sukkot. This is a precious time. We gotta let our family know. So I invited Chris to share a little piece because he was there with me at homecoming, but also just being growing up in this house, I just want him to share his own heart, like a really short 5-minute sharing, and then we're going to worship. Is that good?
Thank you. Yeah, so I was at the IHOP Convergence, and just like Mishi was sharing, she got wrecked. I got wrecked. I was crying so much. I never had this happen to me before. I had a headache the next day because of how much I was crying. I was like, wow. And, you know, there was a lot of things that the Lord was telling me. But I have to be honest, I think one of the things that he has been really pushing my heart in is the area of family. And I think, you know, it's an overused term, especially here at 400. We talk about family a lot, but the heart reality of walking it out is a different thing, because there's things I have to process, there's things I have to sacrifice to really call someone my family, you know, and to really call someone a mom instead of a leader. It's a big step for me, you know, and I think what the Lord was doing in my heart when I was there, you know, I can show you guys a clip, but there's not enough time. They were singing this time in worship where Lord, come and have your inheritance. They were singing it over and over and over and over again. It says, come and have your inheritance, Jesus. And that inheritance is my heart. And that was what the Lord was telling me. He's like, Chris, I think, you know, you are my inheritance, but I want more than just you. I want your heart. And I felt specifically in the area of acknowledging that the part of my heart that needs to acknowledge that IHOP is my family, but more than that, 4Runner is also my family. You know, and I think there's a lot of times where it's so easy just to give up. You know, it's like, yeah, we're family. But then if you were to really ask your own heart, do I really feel this is my family? You know, I think there's a lot of issues that, a lot of anger, a lot of hurts, a lot of different things that you have to process to walk through. And, you know, I think there were some things where like, oh, man, I could see areas of my heart where the Lord was really hitting me on. I mean, I think for me, it's really easy to say, when I'm at a conference, I'm experiencing God, see great moves of God. I see the leadership, they're repenting, they're like reconciling, just like Mishi was doing last week. And it's so easy to, in this place, think, wow, this place is so awesome. Of course IHOP is my family. It's so easy to do, right? But then I think even more than that, I felt what the Lord was saying, Chris, IHOP, you know, this awesome place is more than just, not just this place is your family, but 4Runner is your family in a deeper way too. And I think just really, the Lord was just moving my heart in a great way. And I didn't realize, but I talked with a lot of people at IHOP. You know, IHOP's not exactly a perfect place either. There's a lot of people that are there. I think just for me attending as a visitor sometimes, it's easy to see the good aspects. But to walk with them, there's a lot of pain also that is underneath the surface that you don't know unless you're their staff, that you don't know unless you've been there several years. And you know, for me, I've been at 4Runner several years. It's the same way when other people come to 4Runner. They say, oh, 4Runner is so awesome, and all these things. And we are really awesome, praise the Lord. But there's also other things too. When you walk closer with somebody, you also see their, not just their greatness, you also see their faults. And part of what family involves is walking with people in their faults. Our leaders are not perfect. They are amazing, gifted people. But they're not perfect, and I am not perfect too. But rather than looking at their imperfection, I felt like what the Lord was telling me was, Chris, can you, in a place of sonship, honor your leadership and acknowledge their giftings, acknowledge the inheritance that God has given to them, and to walk with them through their areas where they're still trying to grow in? You know, I think one of the most precious things for me was not the meeting itself, but after the meeting, I think I got a chance to sit down with Mishi and Jupin, and we just got to process what was going on, because I felt like, you know, God, you're doing such an amazing thing in IHOP, but more than that, I don't want just for this to happen in IHOP and for me to come back to 4Runner and it's as if I left something at IHOP. I want to bring this back with me. I want this to be a part of my lifestyle. And so my heart was hungry to want to bring this back in some way. And so I spent time, I talked with Mishi and I talked with Jupin, and I was just processing what was going on. And I think one of the things that was so precious to me, and it's the story that sticks with me, I didn't get Jupin's permission to share too much, so I'll just share the very undetailed version. But the general scope of it is, you know, she's also had to walk through a season in her family where she's learning to honor her parents in the language that they speak, you know. And I think a lot of our parents are very focused on ministry, and that's their you know, that's their passion, that's their love language, and that's what drives them, you know. And then, but sometimes I think what we want to do is we want to know their hearts, we want to know how their life is. Are you doing well? You know, are you you know, how's your life going? How's life with your kids? How's life with general, you know? But then a lot of times it's so easy to get focused on just like actually just to get so focused on ministry and to get so focused. And I'm guilty of that, okay? I confess. I'm very guilty of that. I get really focused on ministry and I put people as a second priority. Okay, and I know just in that place, I have that same thing. So I think for me, just getting to know, well, even in their imperfection, how can I walk with them? How can I speak their language so they feel honored? It's not just like, hey, I honor you. And it's like, you know, at a meeting, everybody's here, you know, we're hugging, we're honoring, and then we can get off the stage. It's a different lifestyle. You know, I was looking for something more than just words. I wanted something that was carried out. And that's what IHOP's doing right now. These next 3 months, that's what they're processing every day. And I said, God, I want to be a part of that. I want, for the next 3 months of my life, I want to be part of the IHOP family. Even though I'm here in Fremont, California, they're there in Kansas City. I want to be able to walk this through. How can you work on me? How can you change me so that I can be transformed in this process? How can I honor my leadership and not criticize their weaknesses, but to walk with them and see the strengths that they have, and to really let them feel honored, to let them really see that I care for them and I want this inheritance rather than just despising it. And I just want to end with this point, which is I think this is definitely a process that I'm going through. There's still a lot of things I think I need to do, but my heart is intent on it. And I just would encourage everybody here. I mean, I think Mishi shared some amazing things, but it's so easy. Just the moment that clock hits 12, my obligation for Sunday is done. Now I get to go back to school or go back to work tomorrow, and then Sunday is just Sunday, right? But I want to encourage you. I'm not saying I'm a perfect example, but I would encourage you to do what I did, which is don't just take this and put it in your head and then just leave it there. I want you to actually get it from head knowledge to heart knowledge. You know, what I did was I talked with my peers. I talked with Mishi, someone I'm running with in ministry. I talked with Jupin, and we're just processing this together. How can we live this out? I know I wanted that, and community helped me do that. So I would just say, as I'm walking this out, I encourage you, you have peers too, you have small group leaders, ask them, how can I be a part of this, Lord? Don't make this just an IHOP thing. I want to make this more than a Forerunner thing. I want to make this my own thing. I want to make this my family thing. And Forerunner is my family. So, you know, it's like, how can we walk this out together? I could share so much more, but I would just throw that at all of us because it's something I'm walking through, and I hope everybody in this place can join me in this process. Talk it through, you know, share it through, pray with each other, and ask the Lord, how can I live this out in my life? And it could be something that's just as simple as what I just shared with you. It's more than just looking at the weaknesses of our fathers, but to honor their strengths and say, God, I want to be a part of that.
Amen. Chris, stay here. Because when we talk about family and family walking together, Chris has literal family in this house. If you guys didn't know, Pastor Rebecca is his aunt. Pastor Rebecca, the awesome, fiery woman. At one point, she was executive pastor, and she was running everything. For about 2 years, she had a lot of pressure. And getting that precious time to process with Chris, because it's different for me than it is for him, because he is literally, his aunt is his leader. And more than that, they live together.
Yes.
So when they leave this meeting room, like, I get to go back to my own home, he gets to go home with his pastor. And they have to live daily life together. And it was painful at times.
There were seasons, yes. You want to share on that? Or?
maybe another day, because, like, it's the gold he's walked through, where he had to learn to humble himself and choose to turn his heart. Our leaders aren't perfect. And sometimes we're just like waiting, like, why can't they just be the father and mother that I want and I need? But sometimes it takes a son and a daughter to recognize and honor them in their place so they could actually stand in it. Do you know what I mean? Like Noah's sons. There was one son that saw the weakness and he shamed his father, but there were two other sons that chose to cover their father instead, cover their weakness so that their father could stand in his place. I think the Lord, in really bringing Forerunner together, family, especially us being part of the English ministry, we think we'll come into it once the Chinese people got their stuff all sorted out. But what if we don't wait? We say, I want to be your family now. In your imperfection and in your weakness, I'm going to choose to be your family now. You know, earlier you saw that video clip of that lady who had that heirloom, right, passed down from generation to generation. And it's a little bit different for you than it is for me. I'm a first generation Christian. Any other first generation? You're the first person in your family to come to know Jesus? First generation. And as a first-generation Christian, you don't really get inheritance from the previous one, right? You're almost having to start everything new. Most of the people in the other room, in the other sanctuary, just a couple hundred feet over that way, if I ask the same question, how many of you guys are first-generation Christians? I bet you almost all your parents will raise your hands. Do you guys know? Are your parents first-generation Christians? Can you raise your hand? Look at it. Look around. Look at it. Your parents were the first ones to come to know Jesus. So they're just learning what it means to be mothers and fathers in the Spirit. They're learning. They're learning. And they don't have it perfect. But they've come to a place where they want to learn. My father was not a Christian. And growing up, I didn't have an inheritance to give. We were like refugees. We ran away from the poverty of Philippines. And then when we came to America, we literally had only like 2 bags, I think, of all of our possession. We didn't have anything. I didn't have toys, actually. For maybe the first 5 years we lived in America, my parents couldn't afford toys, gifts, or anything. I had nothing from Philippines. A lot of people, like, they love, you know, the baby pictures. And you might have, like, albums and albums. Who's got albums of baby pictures at home? Yeah. Your parents take a precious picture. guess what? I don't have anything from before I was 7 years old, because we left it all behind in the Philippines. But what's amazing is what I lacked in my natural family, I've been given in my spiritual one. I look back at the 10 years of the life that I've lived here with you guys. I believe it's been infinitely more. Infinitely more. We might not have come from the same kind of families, but I'm believing there is a great inheritance waiting for you. If you would hunger and thirst for it and receive it, because you recognize the value of it. So I just want to invite you guys to respond. Would you do that? I want to invite you all, if this message moves your heart in any way, say, God, I want to be planted in Florida as my family. I want to choose to walk alongside my leaders. I need to repent of the way that I've had an attitude towards my mothers and fathers. If that's you, I want to just invite you to stand. If you want to respond to this, family, don't wait. Join us in the front. Ask the Lord to come and cleanse our hearts, that He would renew us and bring us together, bond us together in the bonds of love. Family walking together. So I invite everyone to stand, and if that's you especially, I want to invite you to come and stand in the front.
You. last day of the feast. Okay, and also today we hear about the message about homecoming. Okay, so I feel the invitation. God invite us to join the flow, to join the river. Remember in John 7:37 saying that if you are thirsty, okay, and then there will be a river of living water coming up from your innermost part. So are you thirsty? I feel a lot of you guys are touched by the message, but you just don't know how to respond. I invite you to receive the invitation right now. Come forward. Come forward. Let God know I'm thirsty. I'm the one. Need living water. I do need a living water. Okay? Show some action. Okay? God say something. God already invite. But now you need to respond. Come forward. And I'll receive the blessing together as a family.
I'd love for us to join together. So if you guys can all come together. But God is joined together. Let no man separate. Remove everything that hinders. Let not sin get in the way. I want you guys to come. Big family. Let's make a big circle. Embrace each other. Because we are stronger together than we are apart. I come to you. Come a little closer. We are stronger together than we are apart. Family, let's come. Those who stayed all the way to the end, you get the full inheritance. Come on. Yes, it's yours. It's yours. Come on. Yes. Look at this. Generation to generation. So beautiful. Thank you, Lord.
To you, spotless bride.
Yes.
This song.
Come complete our circle, girls. Come on in. Finish our circle.
The day when every nation, tongue, and tribe.
Matthias, come join us.
A spotless bride, and this song
we are missing without our family. Come on in.
This hastening the day when every nation and tribe will be to you. A spotless bride, and this song we now raise. This hastening the day.
History, God. We thank you for this last and the greatest day of the Day of the Tabernacle. I ask for every heart in this room be overflowing with the rivers of living water. God, in our innermost being, let it overflow, overflow. I thank you that as each of us, as sons and daughters, as fathers and mothers take our place, we're going to see the transformation of your kingdom come. Your kingdom come, established in us and through us. We thank you. Bind us together in love. We pray in Jesus' name.